Hi everyone, welcome to episode 2. In the last episode we discussed variables and methods, and today we're going to be looking at classes. Simply put, a class is a means of grouping related methods and variables together. Creating a class can be as simple as writing the keyword class, followed by the name of the class, for example player, and then adding an opening and closing brace between which comes all of the code. Classes aren't only for organization, however, they also allow us to reduce code repetition through something known as inheritance. Let's take a look at an example. So we're trying to recreate the animal kingdom in our game. We might have a class for mammals and a class for birds. If we start writing code in both of these classes, we'll soon realize that they have a lot in common. For example, both birds and mammals need methods to define eating and sleeping behavior. Rather than have the same code in both classes, we could create a new class called Animal, which has this common code in it. Both Mammal and Bird can then inherit from Animal, meaning that they both get access to this functionality. In the Mammal and Bird classes, we can then focus only on what is unique about them. For instance, mammals give live birth to offspring, whereas birds lay eggs and can also fly. Now if we wanted to create an elephant in our game, it could inherit from mammal. Straight away, it has all the functionality of other mammals, eating, sleeping, and giving live birth to offspring. All that the elephant class then needs to define is its unique ability to control a trunk. As you can see, the system of inheritance, going from general shared behavior to more specific behavior, can be a very powerful tool. However, in some cases we're likely to run into some problems with the system. For instance, if we were to create a penguin, we'd find that while it shares some behavior with other birds, it can't fly, instead it swims. Let's have a look at an alternate way of arranging things using the concept of composition instead of inheritance. The idea here is to split the classes up so that each one implements a single behavior, so one class for swimming, another for flying, and so on. We can now assemble any animal we like by simply combining the relevant components. Furthermore, if these components are made generic enough, we could use them again in future projects. Ultimately, we aim to keep our code flexible so that it's easy to introduce changes later on, as well as to minimize code repetition. Inheritance and composition are both tools which enable us to do this. Okay, so in Unity, we generally use classes in one of three ways. We're going to discuss two of them in this video, and the third will form part of a later episode. The first is as a behavioral component. These are the scripts that we attach to the objects in our game to drive their behavior. These classes must inherit from Unity's MonoBehavior class, which simply contains some common object functionality. One example of this functionality is that if we create a method with the name start in our class, MonoBehavior will ensure that it gets called once at the start of the game. Likewise, if we create a method named update, MonoBehavior will make sure that it gets called once every frame while the game is running. So, say I create an enemy class. The colon after the class name indicates that this class inherits from MonoBehavior. Inside the update method, I might create a bool variable called canSeePlayer and set it to false. Then I'd have some code that sets canSeePlayer to true if the player is within a certain distance. Finally, I'd have an if statement, which we'll learn more about later, to say that if the canSeePlayer variable is true, then the enemy should attack the player. Now, we've only written one enemy class, but of course that doesn't mean that there can only be one solitary enemy in our game. Each enemy object can have its own copy, called an instance of the enemy class. Importantly, the variables inside the different instances can have different values while the game is running. In other words, while the game is being played, one enemy's canSeePlayer bool might be true, while at the same time the canSeePlayer bool of another enemy is false. These sorts of variables are called instance variables, since they belong to the individual instances of the class. An instance variable is the default type of variable, so in fact, all variables that we've seen up to this point have been instance variables. The opposite of an instance variable is called a class variable, since it belongs not to one particular instance, but to the class itself. We create class variables by adding the keyword static when we create the variable. To illustrate the difference between class and instance variables, I'm going to create a static integer variable called number of enemies alive, as well as a non-static integer variable called instance example, inside the enemy class. So we have five enemies, and at the start of the game, each of them pluses one to both the number of enemies alive and the instance example variables. Now, when the game is running, the value of number of enemies alive would be equal to 5, while the instance example variable would have a separate value of 1 for each of the 5 enemy instances. Let's say that I wanted to access the number of enemies alive variable from another class. First, we'd have to add the keyword public in front of it to make it accessible to other classes, but now in my other class, I could access the number of enemies alive variable simply by writing enemy dot number of enemies alive, in other words, the class name followed by a dot followed by the variable name. However, if I wanted to know the value of the instance example variable, do you think I could do the same thing? The answer is no. In that case, the computer would ask, which instance of the enemy class do you want me to fetch the value from? And by ask, of course, I just mean that there would be an error. Hopefully this example has made the difference between instance and class variables clear. Note that the same concept of static and non-static applies to methods as well. This leads us to way in which classes are used number 2, static classes. Making an entire class static has two main implications for us to consider. The first is that all of its methods and variables have to be made static as well. The second is that we can't attach this class to objects in our game, since static forbids us from creating instances of it. On the other hand, as we saw with the number of enemies alive example, the restriction of making something static makes it very easy to access from other classes. Because of this, static is extremely well suited to what we call utility classes. An example of a utility class would be a static class called Maths. Inside of this, we might define various things, for example, a static float containing the first 10 digits of pi, or a static method to calculate the square root of a given number. Once again, these are all made public, so that from any other class, if we want to know the value of pi, we just have to write maths.pi, or similarly, if we need to calculate the square root of a number, we can write maths.square root of that number. Alright, that's all the new information for this episode, so let's do a quick recap. Classes are used to group together related methods and variables. We can expand on the functionality of a base class, such as animal, by inheriting from it. Alternatively, we can have each class define a single behavior and build more complex composite behaviors out of these elements. When we attach a class to an object in our game, we are creating an instance of it that belongs specifically to that object. At runtime, values of the variables inside each instance can be different. The exception to this is if the variable is static, in which case it belongs to the class, not to any specific instance. Because of this, making variables and methods static is especially useful in utility classes such as a maths class, as it can then be accessed from other classes without having to get a reference to a specific instance. I hope you enjoyed the episode. As always, feel free to ask me anything you're unsure of in the comments. Until next time, cheers.